6:45, we'll call the meeting back to order. If someone could just close those doors, Matt, so we could have some semblance of quiet in here. Gentlemen, we've asked you and the coaches to come in and thank you all for this great showing of attendance on your part. To come in to both, you know, thank you for the season you gave to the town of Scituate and congratulate you on the results of that season. To make it as far as you made it, you know, we all know is no easy task, a great task, as a matter of fact. And this, you know, this has been a great 3 or 4 years for the Scituate hockey program, and you guys have been a big part of it. And I just, as an aside, before we give out the letters of, read the letters of accommodation, you know, the one thing I did here, and this is probably as important. This is probably as important as going to the garden, and that was that you're just a great bunch of kids, and it looks that way looking at you here tonight. So thank you for being great representatives of the town of Scituate in all the games you played in the league and also in the playoffs in the garden. We thank you very much. We congratulate the coaches. Mike Breen, I understand, is Coach of the Year of Division III, which is... very, very well deserved. We know that, and congratulations to him. Mike, do you think everyone's here, or we don't want to leave anybody out? It looks like any of the parents out there that they want to come in. I wonder, are there any parents out there?
I don't think so. Are there any parents out there?
You probably didn't tell them about it. Okay.
Joe, the only thing, if I can add one quick
absolutely.
Thing. I went to the game at the Garden, and it was a great game. Terrible call there on that trip, and that was incorrect. But the pouring rain and all the people from Scituate, all the fans you had there, I mean, if you looked at the two sides of the Garden, it was just a completely blue wave on the left-hand side, and granted, the other side had to travel a little further, but you had the support of the whole town there in a really miserable day, and it was really a great game and a great season. So, you know, congratulations to everybody. And all the players, I know a lot of players got additional awards on top of that, all scholastic and honorable mention, all those types of things. So, you know, the whole town is very, very proud of the work you guys did.
We also had 16 kids on the honor roll this year, which was...
All right.
That's very good. Well, I think that probably speaks to what I said about, you know, from what I heard during the year, what a great bunch of kids they were. So, anything else? Any board members like to?
I was just going to ask, how many kids are seniors who won't be coming back? Oh, boy.
A lot coming back.
Yeah.
A lot to be back.
Puts a lot of pressure on you guys, the remaining guys.
The only thing I wanted to add, Mr. Chair, was as these guys know, I play hockey still. I played in high school and college, and I still play late Friday nights. And see my last name here. The guys I play with every now and then, some high school guys from Pembroke and down that way still play with us, and they were all sorely disappointed. I went way down in their eyes when they found out I wasn't Jamie's father. Oh, you're Jamie's dad. Oh, and I was like, no, I'm not. And they're like, oh.
Should have said yes.
I know, I should have said yes, but they don't vote.
Gentlemen, for you seniors, congratulations. You know, you've played hockey very well these past 4 years, and you have something to be very proud of. To make it to the States, to win the States, to make it this year again, it's quite an accomplishment. And for the juniors, sophomores, and freshmen, you know, it too is an accomplishment. You have nothing other to look at than yourselves, your hard work, your dedication. It's very important to maintain your school, maintain your scholastics, and I'm very proud, certainly, everybody here, and I'm sure your teachers as well as your parents and coaches are proud knowing that you're doing that. It's not easy doing both. And probably the most important thing going forward for both the seniors and the underclassmen, you do have very good coaches, and you should be very proud of that. It's very hard to have a coach and to try to have somebody who knows and coaches who know hockey or know a sport and try to encourage you to become better athletes and become better persons. And obviously, you know, for Mr. Breen to receive the award he received just this past week from the Boston Globe, it's quite an accomplishment, and it reflects on you folks. So I commend you all, and I wish the seniors well in your endeavors. I hope you're able to continue to play hockey on a competitive level, and if you don't, continue to play regardless, because, you know, you can only – it's a fun sport. So my congratulations to you all.
Thank you. What we'd like to, Mike, would you like to say anything? Just, I hate to put you on the spot like this, but I just did.
No, I appreciate the, all the kind words, and we did have a great season. This was a wonderful group of kids and a group of great parents, too. Judge that with a... left me alone all season, so it was a great, really one of my finest years I've had coaching. It was a great group of kids. The senior class was a really fun class to have leading the team this year.
Good. What we'll do is then John will read the citation that will be given to everybody, and then one by one, if you'd come up in front here, Tony and John will present you with a letter of accommodation.
So the letter reads as follows. It's dated today. It's to the Scituate High School hockey, boys hockey team. Dear members of the Scituate High School hockey team, the Board of Selectmen would like to take this opportunity to congratulate the Scituate High School hockey, boys hockey team on their many accomplishments during the phenomenal 2009 and 2010 season. The team's regular season record was outstanding with 18 wins and only 3 losses. The team then went on to win the following tournaments and titles: the Bourne Tournament, the Pembroke Tournament, the Patriot League Championship, a first for Scituate hockey, the South Sectional Championship, the Eastern Massachusetts Championship, and the State Championship Finals at the TD Bank North Garden in Boston. Experience, dedication, devotion, perseverance, team spirit, and sportsmanship are just a few of the words that accurately describe this multi-talented team. Scituate families, friends, fellow classmates, and coaches all thank you for the honor of allowing us to watch and support Scituate boys hockey for the past 4 years. It's been and will continue to be a, quote, great ride for the players and the town of Scituate fans. The Board of Selectmen and the entire town of Scituate commend each and every one of you on playing your best possible hockey for the team, the coaches, school, and your families. We would like to recognize players Jamie Murray, the captain.
Do you want them to come up when?
Yeah, why don't we do
why
that?
Why don't we do that? Jamie, come on up.
Come on up and we'll...
wave to all your friends on television.
Brian Collins, captain.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Well done.
Great sport.
Keep playing.
Yeah, boy.
Good job. Jeez. Brian Pratt, assistant captain.
Good job.
Mike Cook, assistant captain.
I don't. Well done.
Good job.
Congratulations.
Congratulations. Good job.
Brendan O'Neill.
Well done.
Brendan, good job.
Brendan, congratulations.
Good job, Brendan.
David Lyons.
Nicely done, David.
David, good job.
Thank you, David.
Good job. Congratulations.
Harold Gerbis.
He's on vacation.
Congratulations. Pat Filaro.
He's in Florida.
On vacation, too. Good job,
Pat. Nice. Double good job.
Mitch Warren.
Wow. Well done.
Good job.
Congratulations, Mitch.
Good job, Mitch.
Devin Flynn.
Well done, Heather.
Devin, good job.
Congratulations.
Congratulations, good job.
Kevin Brennan.
Nicely done, Kevin.
Kevin, good job.
Congratulations, Kevin.
Good job, Kevin.
Nick Sherry. Lacrosse, that's okay. Charles Spalt.
Well done, Charles.
Good job, thank you.
Thank you.
Good job, Charles.
Thank you. Cam, I'm going to butcher your last name. Is it Rosada?
Yeah.
Did I say that right? Thank you, Cam. All right. Congratulations.
Nice job, Cam.
Good job. Thank you.
We need their numbers.
Good job, Cam.
Dan Della Russo? Della Grosso. Del Grosso. That's Dan, right. I'm sorry.
I'll just stick with the Dan. Well done.
I'm sorry, Dan. Congratulations.
Good right. job, buddy. Good job.
Dan. Now, Jack, I know yours. Jack Donahue. He had lacrosse. Matt Mitchell.
Yeesh.
You know, Matt. How are you?
21, right?
Well done, Matt.
22.
Hey, Matt. Good to see you.
Good job.
Good job, Matt.
Tucker, I know your last name. Seesaw.
He too is on there.
Okay. And I had his name, too, you know? Frank Sheehan.
Nicely done, Frank.
Frank, good job.
Thank you, Frank. Good job.
Good job. Congratulations.
Andrew Mitchell.
Well done, Andrew.
Andrew, good job. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew.
Good job. Congratulations.
Kevin Cox.
The other Kevin. Nice to meet you, Kevin.
Kevin, thank you. Good job.
Kevin, good job.
Good job, Kevin.
Michael Hassett.
Well done, Michael.
Good job.
Congratulations.
Good job, Michael.
Mike Roeder.
Why is everybody in the hall?
Pockets peddlers.
Well done.
Good job. Thank you.
Mike, thank you. Congratulations.
Good job. Congratulations.
Cody Farrell.
Well done, Cody. Congratulations.
Cody, good job.
Job.
Congratulations.
Mike Gentile.
Well done.
Good job, Mike.
Congratulations. Good job.
Congratulations. Good job, buddy.
Mike Susie. Okay. How about Tim Hall? Tim Hall?
Nice job, Tim. Congratulations.
Good job. Thank you.
Congratulations.
Good job, Tim.
Finally, folks, I'd like to congratulate Mike Green, Kevin Duggan, Officer Eric Steberman, and Jamie Kelly.
Good. We have.
If we can give you this.
We have one kid off there, Johnny Callahan.
Did we? Johnny, come on up.
Johnny.
8 goals in the
playoffs. Yeah, wow. Well, we wanted to come on.
Sure, get him in there.
We wanted to make sure he got recognized. John. Congratulations.
Thank you, John.
Good job. Congratulations.
Did we get everybody? I hope. We got everybody good.
Thank you, guys. Great job. Thank you. Some of these for the guys.
Here you go.
Mike, thank you.
Eric, way to go.
Mike, this
Eric, good
you
seeing you, pal.
I've got the extra ones
for you. Ties.
I thought you might be responsible for all the kids getting on the honor roll. Maybe tutoring. That's what I was going to say.
He went to St. Mike's, absolutely.
Now I know you'd all like to stay around for the next 3 hours for our meeting, but...
Thanks, guys.
Congratulations to you all. John, you did great on all the Irish names. It was the Italian ones that threw you up.
I forgot John Callahan. No, that was my fault. He was on the list. So,
Del Grosso,
so folks, John Callahan should get... I'm going to mention his name a few times tonight to make up for
just to throw it in there.
Just to make amends.
Every time I say waterways, you can say Johnny Callahan.
I'm going to say
Johnny. That'll be 5 or 10 times. Yeah, that's right.
The next item is the Discussion vote, Hocker Peddler's license renewals, renewals and new licenses. I think before we actually vote anything here, I think we've, there's been some questions raised about the difference between a farmer's market and a flea market type thing, or a yard flea market type thing. So I thought the board would have a little discussion on how we understand what a farmer's market is, or what a farmer's market is intended to be. And is that, in fact, what we have here? So it was my understanding, I'll start it off, it was my understanding last year when we voted for this farmer's market that it was going to be indeed a farmer's market with locally grown produce, if not locally grown fresh produce. But as we looked at the applications tonight for new permits due, to go to the market and to sell their wares, I don't know if there were any farm-grown products at all. There were very interesting items, but none of it was what we'd call farm-grown, I guess, but I'd call farm-grown. So I think that it would be useful to have a little discussion first on what last year, what we understood to be the purpose of the not Scituate parking lot being used for. So I'll open it up on that note. Rick Murray.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, thank you for bringing that up, because I completely agree with you. I've got no problem at all with a farmer's market. I actually have no problem really with a flea market or something like that, but I just want to make sure we are approving what we're approving. I want to make sure we're doing it under the right auspices. In particular regarding sort of flea market, non-produce, non-food type things, I'm concerned that we might be cannibalizing from the regular merchants on Front Street and in North Scituate. And so, you know, I understand people are selling handbags and things like that, Scituate residents and non-Scituate residents, and that all on face value. I got nothing against people selling handbags and so on, but I'm well aware also that we have merchants in North Scituate and on Front Street that are also doing the same thing. And I, for one, before I would vote to approve non-farmers market type things, I'd really want to have some signal from either the chamber or the, what's it called, the Merchants Association, or some additional feedback about non-produce, non-food type things. And it's not that I'm against handbags and non-food type things, but I just want to make sure that we're doing it above board and the discussion is actually about that. I'm fine with anything having to do with food and produce and, you know, and things like that. But the other stuff I think warrants a separate discussion. And at least for me, I'd like to have, you know, the businesses chime in as to whether they see this as a problem, or on the other hand, it could be a magnet. It could be a good thing, people coming in and so on. I just want their feedback. So those are my two cents on those two separate issues.
Any other comments?
Sure. I obviously I looked at the applications and I was looking at them. I actually thought those the new applicants as well as some of the renewals kind of made sense. You know, from a traditional standpoint, if we're talking about a farmer's market, years ago, clearly it was a time where farmers, when Scituate had a number of farms, would go down into an area and sell their produce. Times changed and began to have markets, so they'd go down to the markets and sell it. And now times have changed even more. Now we have supermarkets and large chain stores who sell produce from down south and all over the place. You know, obviously there are no farms other than two in Scituate right now, and they're selling what they're selling at their stands. I think there's actually, I know there are two. So, you know, the term farmer's market is probably a little of a misnomer, but I don't think it's a flea market. My understanding of a flea market, and I didn't look it up, is basically the bric-a-brac that people have that they bring and they sell. What I've noticed from the applications is that they're selling things that are actually made, when, you know, one of which is like chocolate, they're selling, you know, homemade organic items for dog toys, and, you know, they have other items, you know, their lobsters, their eggs last year, their other produce that were coming, and jewelry, all homemade, most of which are actually made within the town. You know, other type of markets I've been to where people have gone out and tried to start off a business, they start in this type of venue. And then from there, like a Paul Cuxtus with the signs, they make these signs, and then all of a sudden he became a merchant, was able to sell it because it became popular. I think, you know, when I look at this, you know, farmer's market, my attitude is let the economy make it. Let the, you know, if people aren't going to buy what they're selling, then they're going to dry up and go. As far as competing, you know, I didn't hear anything from the merchants. I didn't hear anything from the chamber. I'm the liaison. I'm actually a vice president of the chamber. Nobody raised anything. Now, I can't say that that wasn't raised at the merchants because I didn't go to the Merchants Association. Yep. It's a separate organization from the chamber. But that was never raised. And again, the merchants are only the associations down in Front Street. There was one in North Scituate, but my understanding is that is there's still a loose confederation of people who talk. I think it accentuates, I think it complements it. It's only one day a week. It's on the middle of the week on Wednesday. I tend to say my position on it is, I mean, if they're coming in with bric-a-brac, more of a flea market, then I'd probably be inclined to say no. But from what I see people trying to make money, people who are making home accessories, like baby accessories. I see one here. There's one about specialty meats. Most, if not all these people, not all, but most of these people are here from Scituate. So I tend to think, let it go again to see how it goes. If it becomes unruly, if it becomes messy, if it turns into a, well, I won't say what I was just going to say, but if it turns into a junk, then I would be inclined to say, yeah. But I think they police themselves well. So I don't have a problem with it. I think, you know, let the laissez-faire economy decide whether people want to buy it or not. Right. And if that's the case, then so be it.
Because I have a quick follow-up, just to make sure I want to understand. So, because you said something that I definitely needed to hear, which I brought up. So, as far as you know, and I know this is not binding, but as far as you know, I mean, and you'd be the guy, no one from the chamber has been coming up to you and saying, what's going on with these other people selling stuff up there? No. That's what I needed to hear. That's very important. And I do agree with you. I did not mean to imply, and I apologize if I did, but I don't think I did, that this stuff wasn't high quality or handmade, and it's not take it or leave it stuff being brought up. I completely understand that.
That was the term I was going to take.
I know, but I said it, not you.
Yeah,
so all right,
but
no, I appreciate the I appreciate you answering that for me. Thank you.
Just one quick comment.
Sure.
Yeah, the only thing I'd add. Last time we talked about it, you know, I think what we have is kind of a misnaming. It's not a farmer's market. It's a open market, a Scituate market, or something like that.
Yeah.
The product here is high-quality products, and I think that's what the board is really concerned with, keeping it at a high level, and from what I see, it is. And I think when I went into it last year, I was concerned even about the food vendors in town, what their response would be for it. And we haven't gotten any negative feedback at all. So I think that's kind of our gauge. As long as there's no negative feedback from either citizens or from other merchants, then I'm fine with it. As John mentioned, it's only a Wednesday afternoon from 3 to 7. It's a limited time, and I assume people are going. I mean, everyone keeps renewing, so you must have some sort of turnout there. So that's great. So we wish you success.
John, good stuff. Echo a lot of what John had to say. It's started out as, you know, a farmer's market. I think I was talking to Mark Flaherty about it, but like John alluded to, it's going to change. Products are going to change. People are going to make crafts and things. And if they, like John said, if they sell, they sell. And if they don't, then they move on to other things. I just had one comment. John touched on it. I don't know if it's always, I know some of the folks out there, it's not always about making money. Some of them have children that might be teenagers or something like that, and they're just trying to teach them some responsibilities and little simple lessons in life. I just had one thought. I think I mentioned it to Joe a couple of days ago, and I haven't been to Cohasset or Hingham. Maybe you guys have. And if this is what it's going to take to make this go, you know, I'd be in favor of, you know, all of these applicants here without a problem, because I think those two towns have a very successful farm, you know, market. So I support it. Good luck to them.
Without.
Want a motion?
Yeah. Why don't we go right to it? Yeah.
Move that the Board of Selectmen vote to grant a Hawker's Peddler license to Sheila C. Matthews, DBA Beach Buns, 27 Carlton Road, Marshfield, Massachusetts. Memorial Day to Labor Day, Hummerock site only. Waiver of the 15-minute rule, noon to 5 p.m. with one extension, 7 p.m. on July 3rd and September 3rd, 4th, and 5th, 2010. This license will be released upon successful inspection by the Health Board.
Second.
No.
Motion's been made and seconded. Discussion, Kim.
If I could just clarify, this is a new Hawker Peddler's license for a hot dog cart. This is
separate from...
Excuse me, from the... This is not a North Scituate site or the farmer's market.
Go down to two.
Pardon?
Go down, drop down to two.
But you want to do them one at a time? Whatever the board's pleasure is.
Well, do we want to discuss that? Obviously, as I started reading it, I realized it wasn't.
Is the applicant here? Would you mind just coming up just to answer a question or two if we might have them?
Yeah, we can do it now.
You know, your plan is a hot dog cart in Hummerock?
Yes, it is.
And the only reason I'm bringing you up is because it's different from what we just talked about.
I understand.
Have you done this before?
I have not.
Okay.
So this is new to me.
Yeah.
That's correct.
Okay.
But I have done a fair amount of research on it and have identified a cart. Would we run out of... I've spoken to the Board of Health here and have a lot of teen labor within my household. So I've identified the cart. I've spoken to the Health Department, as I said, in terms of the requirements. Did want to make sure I would be able to move forward with this location before I actually purchased the cart. I do understand that I need to work out of a commissary or restaurant, and I have identified that site as well. Because you do need to obviously not work out of your home, but out of a restaurant. So
where is the site?
Hummerock.
I mean, we're in Hummerock.
Would
you have the cart? Where would you?
The site that I had identified in the application, I put it would be just inside, just before the entrance to the beach.
Okay.
Just past the parking lot where the kind of jersey barriers are.
Yeah, where the rocks are. This would be a cart that actually has handles, and it's not terribly large, so it would be able to be maneuvered in and out easily.
Do you have a picture of it by any chance?
I didn't bring the picture with me. It's about 4 feet by 4 feet. 4 feet wide, 4 feet.
Is it made out of wood or metal?
It's stainless steel. Stainless steel, and it would just be hot dogs, drinks, and chips, nothing else.
Yeah, I appreciate you pointing out that the San Zen sells ice cream and slush, and you would not be selling, you'd be selling neither of those, given the fact you're pretty close to them. So I really appreciate that.
Yeah, no, and as I said, it's really more kind of a summer job thing for some teenagers. Obviously, I don't work in the summer. It would be with close supervision, but... You know, not to cannibalize their business at all.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you.
Further discussion?
Do you have a second for Tony's motion?
Not yet.
Yes, I second it.
I do. I guess I do. Thank you. Motion's been made and seconded. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Good luck. Tony, you want to take the next
one? Yeah, I'll do the. Move the Board of Selectmen vote to renew the Hawker Peddler's license for the North Scituate Farmers Market to Angela Trafton, Mark and Elizabeth Flaherty, and Lane's Lobsters for 2010 season.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Unanimous?
The third one, move the Board of Selectmen vote to approve a Hawker's Peddler license for the North Scituate Farmers Market to Roman McCall, Danielle Verzone, Crystal Joyce, Patience Taylor, Leslie Brigham and Melanie Lacourier, and Holly Hess for Wednesdays from 3 to 7 at the commuter rail parking lot in front of the WPA building in North Scituate. Temporary waiver of the 15-minute rule and Selectman's Policy Number 43-99 from May 1st to October 31st for successful inspection by the Board of Health when necessary.
Second.
What's the 15-minute rule for the parking lot? Okay, so it's not for this parking. It's our general policy. Motion made. Has it been seconded?
Yep.
Motion been made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Unanimous? Good luck.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And thanks for that discussion ahead of time, too. That was very helpful.
Okay. Moving right along. A belated walk-in period. Norman's on the TV, so Donna? How are you guys? How are you both doing? Good. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Doing well.
Sam Joyce Farrell. I live on Manor Road.
Donna Banger, 108 Captain Pierce.
And we're representing the Beautification Commission and just want to inform you of Shipshape Day, which will be May 1st. And the hours will be 8 to 1. And people can come to Town Hall at that time to pick up bags to proceed with the collection of debris around the streets.
Just at Town Hall, that's the only distribution point?
Yes.
Okay. Town Hall, May 1st. What time?
8 to 1.
8 to 1.
And we want to acknowledge our appreciation of the police department for their participation. They make this possible, keep our volunteers safe, and also Mike Breen's highway department employees who pick up the bags that people leave.
You know, I think it's important to note this year, of all years it's important, but this year with the flooding and the high tides and all the debris that came out of the ocean, out of people's cellars, out of backyards and every place else, I think it's most important to do a great job this year because we have, I think, a lot more debris around our streets, unfortunately, so.
Yes, I'm sure.
I was gonna try and explain quickly, but Donna, you probably do it better. If people want to get involved, what do they actually do? They come down, there's a couple of stations at Town Hall, so they'd come down there and pick up a blue bag.
Mm-hmm. Actually, they're green bags.
Green bags.
They say Shipshape Situate, no tongue twister. It's the only time you can ever use these bags and that they will be accepted, you know, at the transfer station. But you pick up your bags, gloves. This year we'll have some trash, some mechanical trash pickers, nifty nabbers they're called. And we assign you a territory. You can request the street you want to pick up or the beach or wherever it is you choose to work. And when you're finished, you leave your filled bag at the roadside and you're done. That's it. And you pick up your supplies between 8 and 1, but you can work at any time during the day that's after the soccer games or after lunch or whatever it is that's convenient.
Yeah, then you just leave, you pick it up, you don't have to dispose of the bag, you just leave it at the facility and someone will come pick it up.
Right, that's right. Great. We had a great year last year. We hope all those people who came last year will come again this year and a few more. And we have a website if you want to email us with questions or pick your spot. I can give it to you. It's sbc@town.situate.ma.us.
I'm sure the Mariner as diligent as they are, will pick that website up and
yes,
run with it.
Yes, we want to talk to the Mariner anyway. Yeah.
So that's Scituate Beautification Committee, SBC.
SBC, mm-hmm. Yes.
Great.
Yeah.
Just a quick question to Howie and Dicker here. Is this being coordinated with Harbor Cleanup, do you happen to know? No? Okay.
It's separate.
We ask because we like to publicize all the cleanups.
Yeah.
You know, and they I don't think they've picked a date yet.
Yeah, I don't think they have either. Just was wondering. Okay, that's great.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Next agenda item is an amendment to the town's traffic rules and regulations. I think Mark Thompson is here. Bring us up to date on what he's attempting to do. Mark, welcome. Thank you.
Hey, Mark.
How are you doing? I think we have three items out there tonight. The first one is with regards to library parking.
Yep.
And with the volume of traffic that's been going on up there and some of the particular events that they've been having, there was concern with regards to particularly the entranceway in there.
Mm-hmm.
People parking on both sides and emergency apparatus being able to get in. So that's the first item addresses that with regards to 140 feet of parking on either side of the roadway being restricted.
Okay.
Both sides.
And that'll be signs put up?
Signs put up. I believe the highway's going to handle that.
Okay.
Do you want a motion on each of these? You want to wait till the end?
No, why don't we wait until we finish them?
Go through each one?
Yeah.
Can you, what, just explain that. So, 140 feet of, what do they have to do? What is that changing, actually?
It's not, there's not an actual physical change. It's basically just from Branch Street and then measuring up 140 feet up the drive into the library area, which is basically just that narrow.
So there's just no parking in that area?
There'd be no parking on either side. And I think ultimately the idea would be to deal with, in a more permanent way, some overflow parking as these library programs continue and they've got more and more people up there.
Right.
But having this in place will allow emergency access.
So there'll just be signs on both sides there saying?
Can they park on Branch Street? In other words?
I don't think they would be parking on Branch Street. There's some overflow parking by Central Park Drive. Right. There's a gravel drive right as you go up in there, and that would be the preferred place. And I think that they're directing people over
there. That's
now.
Where they're going.
Okay. We'll also make it clear that that no parking zone now also applies at night?
On this, yes, will be all the time.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah, it'd be important to have the signs make that really clear because there's a lot of evening stuff that goes on, as you well know, and people might say, okay, well, it's nighttime, this doesn't apply. All right.
The second item is with regards to waterfront zones. And in the motion itself, it details several places, particularly the beach lots throughout towns that need to be added into the traffic guidelines. Those aren't currently in there, so we'll be adding those. In addition to that, it would be increasing the fine on the ticket from $40 to $50. And that $50 is the maximum amount allowed under Mass General Law. So that additional $10 jump will hopefully be acting as a little bit more of a deterrent for people who are currently parking in these water zones.
So is that during, in other words, they have to have a beach sticker, Mark? Is that it?
That
in order to park there?
Okay. That would be a beach
and
sticker.
Is that year-round then now, or is it just only during the season, you know, like during the beach season?
I believe this is a year-round change.
Okay. Okay.
And the final item, and this is one that most other towns have already adopted, and this is something that we would just be looking to get in line with. Currently, on a motor vehicle stop under Chapter 90, we would be able to write citations for people who don't have the registration plate sticker on their plate for an unregistered motor vehicle for having an expired inspection sticker. So what this basically adds in is on that same town citation, we would be able to write, even if the vehicle's not occupied, the owner of the vehicle could get a ticket. So if somebody's parked in the beach parking lot with an unregistered motor vehicle or with something that has an expired inspection sticker on it, it would give us the ability to write a fine on that.
Okay.
But that's also not just the beach parking lot, it's anywhere.
Correct, that would be anywhere. But
so like if I have a car that I've let the registration lapse on because I'm not using it, I can't just park it in the street without getting ticketed.
Correct. If it's somewhere that's parked on a public way and we have the right to ticket there,
right,
this would then be in effect.
Great.
Actually, you're doing them a favor by giving them a ticket because if you're in operating it, you could potentially be arrested.
Yeah, yeah, that's true.
So
yeah, yeah.
By doing the ticket, you're being told don't drive. So
yeah.
That's kind of
discussion on any one of these three, Sean?
Not of these three. I just, while I have them here, can I just?
Yep.
One thing then, and I think we've mentioned it to Al, Mark, if you could, you know, talk to the traffic rules about the next 6 months to really enforce parking during snow removal and snowing operations. And it's just, you just have to keep hammering that home. It's just really difficult, you know, and costly for equipment to try to clean the streets with vehicles parked. And I just had one other thought, if I could, Joe.
Absolutely.
Could you bring one little yield sign to a stop sign back to the traffic rules if you go down Stockbridge Road to...
I think we've already done that.
We have.
I get my marching orders from a gentleman in town and...
But we haven't voted it yet, have we?
No, we haven't.
All right,
it's
good.
In front of...
Oh, good. All right, good.
Yep. Meeting
all right, good.
Good. Taken care
Thank
of.
Thank you, Joe.
You're welcome.
Thank you. All right, that's it.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mark.
So all motions?
Now we'll take motions.
All right, to schedule two waterfront zones of the town traffic rules and regulations, add section 3 titled parking prohibitions and add beach parking areas with language as follows. Following parking areas are designated as waterfront zones: Glades Road parking lot south, Glades Road parking lot north, Bailey's Causeway parking lot east, Bailey's Causeway parking lot west, Egypt Beach parking lot, Oceanside Drive parking lot, Sand Hills parking lot, Peggotty Beach parking lot, Humrock Beach parking lot, in accordance with the authority granted to the Board of Selectmen under Chapter 90, Section 20A,
and a half of the Massachusetts General Laws. Penalty of $50 is set for a violation of any rule regulating the parking of vehicles in these areas.
Second.
Motion been made and seconded. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That's unanimous.
Add to traffic rules and regulations, Schedule 1, Parking, Section 2, Subsection E, Public Parking Areas. Under that subsection, add Town Library Parking Area Access Road from Branch Street at 140 feet south both sides and adjacent to the south traffic island both sides as posted.
Second.
Motion been made and seconded. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That's unanimous.
Request that Section 6, Stopping, Standing, Parking, 3460 of the Traffic Rules and Regulations be amended as follows. 3460.1-General Prohibitions. No person shall allow, permit, or suffer any vehicle registered in his name to stand or park in any street, way, highway, road, or parkway under the control of the Town of Scituate in violation of any of the traffic rules or orders adopted by the Board of Selectmen, in particular, in any of the following places except when necessary to avoid conflict with other traffic, compliance with the direction of a police officer or traffic turn, traffic signal, or traffic sign or signal. Add subsections. Unless the vehicle displays a valid registration plate as required by Chapter 90 of the Massachusetts General Law. Unless the vehicle displays a valid certificate of inspection as required by Chapter 90 of the Massachusetts General Laws. Add under Section 10, Penalties and Repeals 34100, subsections, failure to display valid registration plate, $25. Failure to display valid certificate of inspection, $25. Fine for these violations in a waterfront zone, $40. Also, Schedule 1, Parking, Section 1, delete Tilden Road exclusion, refer to Executive Action, Ray Wampatuck School Parking, 2010.
Second.
Motion been made and seconded. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Thank you, Mark.
Thanks, Mark.
You too. Yeah, you as well.
Next item is the use of Scituate Marine Park. Dick?
Can I approach you with these?
Thank you.
As you know, you need another.
Thank you, Dick.
The SMC is self-supporting, and we are planning to have various activities. So I'm coming to you to have permission to use the facility. This is not the final draft. This is what I could come up with beforehand. For the flea market on the 23rd of May, they have suggested that I have a rain date of the 30th, so that money would be added. This is on the grounds of the Scituate Marine Park, and that date has been set. The second thing I gave you was for a safety flare demonstration, which would be working with, it needs to be approved, of course, by the Coast Guard, the environmental police, the state police, the local police, the harbor master, and everything else. And we also would work with the fire department for demonstrations. So what I'm looking for is permission to use the grounds, and I have two specific requests, these two. I don't have a date in June for the flare demonstration because it takes so many people to coordinate, and I needed to know that I could use it before I even asked them. I would ask in the long run for small events like this, which do not tie up anything in town, that you could give me more of a blanket authorization to support the Scituate Maritime Center.
So this is a request tonight for that blanket authorization or for the...
I'd like it to be blanket for small things because it would be a nuisance to have to keep coming up several months beforehand. I don't plan any large events. I don't plan to have any great traffic. As a matter of fact, if you look at this picture was taken at our open house. And you can see that we do not tend to have a lot of traffic and we have plenty of parking. So I don't think that it would affect the town. I am working with the town administrator, and I keep a calendar, which you can see on our web page, which shows not only town events, but events at the Scituate Maritime Center, so they're well coordinated already. We don't plan events when there are other things going on in town, such as the decathlon or the shore race or any of those other things. We tend to keep them away because we don't want to have that be a problem.
Rick Murray, start us off.
In terms of these specific ones, I have no problem with, and I assume you've coordinated with Mark Patterson, the harbor master?
Absolutely.
And as well as the boatyard folk?
Yes.
Okay. Regarding, and with Tricia, I understand because this is the land, this is a board of selectmen, not town administrator, but if it was the building, that would be the town administrator. Okay, so that's one of the distinctions that I learned today. Regarding a blanket approval, in principle, I have no problem with that, but I would only do it if it was subject to permission from the harbor master, waterways commission, and Tricia to sign off on.
It's the first I've heard of it, and since this is the first year of operation for the Marine Center, I wouldn't want Dick to go and schedule several events and have one or two be problematic for the town, and then we have no chance to regroup.
That's exactly right.
I mean, I think these two events are great. I can't understand what is the problem with coming before? Is it, I mean, I think you can...
Well, for example, this one is on the 23rd of May. I don't have a lot of time to do all the coordination and other events like that when I have to involve the Coast Guard, the Environmental Police, the State Police, the Harbor Master, all the rest of that for these kinds of events which will support the center. I don't have a problem going to the town administrator, the harbor master, and asking, can we do that? But it is not something where I can come to you and, well, I asked for this over a month ago. I presented it 2 months ago at the Waterways Commission. And it just takes a long time to go through it, and you can't say, well, then I'll do it because the season will be over.
But we meet every 2 weeks.
I understand that, but you didn't meet 2 weeks ago, and I applied more than that to meet. To request that, so I don't think we have a big deal here, but I don't know what's going to come up next. I'm trying.
Well, that's the point. We don't have a big deal until we do.
Right.
You know, and I think by bringing events to us, someone up here may have knowledge about something else that's going on in town that the other people may not.
Well, I understand that. As I've said to you, I'm already coordinating with the town administrator. If you look at our webpage, all the town events are on our webpage in addition to our own events at the SMC. So we are recording that, and it can be seen by everybody here. The Harbor Master has access to it. Every member of the committee that represents the activities we do there. So I don't think it's a problem, but, well, I'm a little concerned, as I say, because May 23rd is around the corner for me, and I have a lot to do to do a flea market.
Sure. Well, I'm just to reiterate, I'm totally in favor of both these things, and I don't know how, Mr. Chair, you want to proceed. Do we want to go these things first and then talk about the larger issue, or postpone the larger issue?
Well, I
want to make sure we don't want to. I don't want to hold this up.
Yeah,
I don't want to hold this up over a larger issue. I am a little, frankly, disturbed that this is the first that the town administrator has heard of this, and that's not a comment on the town administrator. Before you brought up to us some sort of blanket approval, I would have appreciated having it sort of vetted and discussed before that.
Fair enough. I just thought of it tonight because of my concern.
Okay, so, you know, particularly if you've just thought of it tonight, then I really want to get it vetted by other people first. So I'm fine with these two things.
But I don't feel a lot of enthusiasm for a blanket approval.
Yeah, at least not tonight.
I just had an observation, Dick. I noticed on an email that I had as a backup, somebody was requesting 4 days in May to be able to use the Marine Center. Is that, in other words, is that typical? I know this is your first year, but I'm saying our request coming in not just for an afternoon, but for like 4 days in a row to use the Marine Center.
You mean the sailing, the J-24?
Yeah,
that's what I happen to see.
Right, that just came through us. That isn't our event. They just simply asked us, and the only thing they've asked us that we've agreed to was they wanted to have a party that Saturday night.
Okay.
The rest of it, I have suggested they go back to you or the town administrator because that is not something we have.
The reason why I asked that, Dick, is because, because it begs the question, I think, because this is our first year, in essence, having it, running it, we're kind of working our way through it, and maybe you might be thinking we're micromanaging it, but you know, I think just from a board perspective, we're probably trying to figure out, let's see how the first year goes. If it gets so involved, truth be told, we're not going to be able to handle it. We've got too many other things to be handling, and I'm sure then we'll begin to kind of delegate and go that route. So I think working together is important to kind of get through this first year. The reason why I raised this issue is because I kind of thought this through, and I was thinking, if somebody wants to, shall we say, I guess rent or lease it out from us for 4 days, then I think we as a town need to have something in place to think about what's the difference if it's a week or extending it to 4 weeks or extending it. In other words, not that anybody would say, yeah, we're going to rent it out for a whole month or anything, but my whole thought process was to say, okay, I think we have to have something in place to think about it, because right off the bat, I was thinking, well, somebody might want to lease it for the afternoon or for, you know, for different events. I hadn't, when I saw 4 days, I was like, wow, that seems long, but then again, when you're having a sailing event, I can understand that now perfectly. I'm not a sailor, so I don't get that benefit, but I understand what the event is. But I think that's something that needs to be kind of worked out. That's kind of my thought process.
That's about the Maritime Center.
Correct.
That's
Well, they're not renting the Maritime Center for 4 days.
Okay. The email just seemed to say, it says, reserve the Scituate Maritime Center for 4 days in May. So the email said they were saying, and I'm not saying they're not, but I'm just saying that's the impression I was left with.
Okay, they meant to say the Scituate Maritime Park, because they're going to ask you, they're having a sailing event, and they want to center it on there, and I've said to them, you'll have to go to the town, well, the Board of Selectmen to make that request, because I don't have anything to do with it.
Clear. Yeah.
That was just the question that came through my mind.
But it is on
saying
the
we have
calendar.
To figure it out. I got
that
you.
Was why it came there, so that people would know that there is a sailing event, and it's on the calendar that describes the Scituate Maritime Park.
And just to reiterate something that several of us are aware of, but Dick, Howie, John Murphy, who's chair of Waterways Commission, Tricia, Mark Patterson, Joe, and myself, we had a meeting in Tricia's office a month and a half or so ago. Where we're talking only about the Maritime Center and the progress towards getting an MOU between the nonprofit and the town. And in the interim, we decided that Dick would get up the schedule, and he would be renting out some of those small things, John, that you were talking about. Someone wanted to use it for an afternoon or something, but Dick would be the main focus point, but he would give approval only after checking with Tricia and Mark. So we had the harbor side of town, we had the administrative side of town, and we had the main contact all on the same page with that schedule to exactly address that point. But we are, or they are, working on the draft MOU in terms of a fee structure and all that sort of stuff based on a budget that Tricia and Mark and Al Bangert put together, and others, I think, as well, in terms of what it will cost to operate the Maritime Center to make sure we recover as much of those costs as possible. And that's ongoing. And so, and there's good progress on that, but it's ongoing. And that's exactly where we're headed on that.
John?
My concern is the boat operator on board with us? This is a busy time of year. Can he launch boats, paint boats, do what he has to do while this flea market's going on?
He approved of it, he heard about it, and said he welcomed it. And we talked about traffic control and whatever he needed for that.
Okay. Can I, if I have a boat down there, can I go down and work on it, or is it insurance prohibit me from working on my own boat? How does that work? Some boat yards you cannot work on your own boat because of insurance regulations.
If you keep your boat there, right, and you have it with a contract with Scituate Boat Works.
Right.
I don't recall the exact wording, but you know, there's many things that you can do on your own. That was a main requirement that we had when we were selecting the successful operator.
You know, I have visions of this thing taking off and cars parked all the way over to Edward, you know, the bridge and stuff, and then people trying to paint their boats if it's a nice weekend, and hopefully that doesn't happen. Nope. In some ways, I hope it does happen. A lot of people will buy and sell things and be really happy.
I will say one thing, one more thing. This time I'm fine with it, but in the future I would like, I mean, I trust you, Dick, I know you and all that sort of stuff, but I would like a letter from Mark saying that it's all right with the boatyard or something like that on this. Just to make sure that everybody is truly on board.
Brian Curie said that he expects to have all the boats in of the parking area, which is, you see, our portion of that lot, we take over 2/3 of it as of the 15th of May.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
So he has an obligation actually to move it there. to answer your other question, you can't paint your boat because of environmental concerns.
Well, you wax it.
But there's other things you can do.
Yeah, but you know what I mean. Just
there's a bunch of stuff you can do within the environmental regulations.
But he did understand that, and we picked this date because it's after the launch date.
All right, good. I'm trying to find ways not to have a problem with the flea market thing. I'm also looking at the picture, and honestly, I don't see a lot of space there to have a flea market.
Well, Joe, the...
Let me just get this other point.
Yeah, sure, sorry.
It's the week after the slips open up. I think the slips historically open up the May 15th. And a lot of boats go in May 15th. There's no question about that. But I'll bet you an equal amount of boats go in May 23rd, the next weekend.
Sure.
I see a lot of boating activity down there that week in my own mind. And also, I guess I have a concern that it's one thing to have a flea market at the parking lot in North Scituate. You know, it's relatively residential free. But it's another thing to have one on First Cliff. Are we getting into an area now that we're putting commercial ventures, regardless of the great benefit that one may receive from it, in this case, the Maritime Center Foundation will receive money, are we running into a situation here where we're putting this type of thing in a residential area? And I have to say, I think we are, and I guess I'm not comfortable with it. I guess the Power Squadron demonstration, certainly there's justification for that, and it's a safety issue. And I don't see that taking up a great deal of space. I know it's limited to 25 participants, I guess. I mean, 25 people would be given the demonstration at any given time. So a demonstration wouldn't take up maybe half the parking lot. So I got to be honest, I have a problem with the flea market. I don't have a problem with the rationale behind it. I don't have a problem with the cause, but I have a problem with what I perceive as a very busy, maybe the busiest weekend of the year, other than sometime in September when the boats are coming out, the second busiest weekend of the year. And even though it's for us, it's still a commercial venture in a residential area. So that's my problem, but be what as it may.
What's your response to it being a very busy boating weekend?
Well, as I said, if you look at this picture, this was the open house, and people came and went. We think there were 200 people there, and it was never that terribly busy. The flea market is only open for 3 hours. My typical view of flea markets, if you look them on streets, is people come and go and are there for about 15 minutes to half an hour, and then they're gone. We have plenty of parking. We have 180 spaces in that area. I don't see it as being a particularly busy. I'm flattered. Everybody tells me this is going to be a wonderful thing. I was figuring that maybe I could sell 20 tables and find 50 people there. Now I'm hearing, no, you're going to have 50 tables and 500 people there. I would love to see that, and I think that would be bad, as Joe suggests, but I have no idea what it's really going to be. It's never been done. I don't know what it's going to be like. We had a discussion today and thought maybe what we do is put some of the people inside the building, which would be nice. But we were going to limit the number of tables, and we were going to have people taking their attendance fee as they came in, so we would have control over that kind of thing.
Why not do it in June?
Oh, you'll notice here I picked it out for, say, boating week. There are a number of reasons. People tend, if you're a boater, you tend to want to clean out your basement and then spend the whole summer boating. You don't tend to go to these kinds of flea markets in the middle of the season. It's, I need something for my boat. I bought it. Now I'm boating the whole season. And that's why I picked that date. The end of the season, maybe, but it, most people are now thinking about putting their boats away. And it also is National Safe Boating Week, which is something that I wanted, since I work with the Coast Guard Auxiliary and the Power Squadron, I figured that would be, have both of those tables there promoting safe boating, wear your life jacket, that sort of thing.
Dick, that, for more information number there, which, who's that? Now that's, is that?
Oh, that's my cell phone.
That's your cell phone, okay.
That's the only thing I could offer.
Yep.
We don't have a phone there.
Yep. How would the board like to proceed? I would suggest that we take maybe the, what appears to be the easiest one first. Maybe it isn't. That's the safety flare demonstration.
I would, well, we don't have a date yet on the safety flare demonstration because he I understand the point that he wanted to come to us to get approval before he, that's all for the one up at Hull.
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
It would be probably in June, but I can't say specifically because of the large number of people that have to sign off on it. You can't shoot a flare off without all these.
I know that. Yeah. This is a question for Kim. Are we sufficiently covered if we say for a date to be determined in June?
I would suggest picking a couple of dates in June and then, you know, choosing one. I mean, you know, he could use a couple of dates. So if you, are you doing a Saturday or Sunday? Is that
it would be doing? A Saturday, most likely. Okay. That's when we did it last time.
Even if we said a Saturday.
Either the 12th or the 19th, I mean, if we gave you a couple of Saturdays.
I can certainly try.
Does that make sense?
Even a Saturday in June, do we care?
Doesn't matter to me which one it was. Give them
I'll
some
just say a Saturday in June. All right, let me just give this a shot then. Move the board.
I'm sorry.
No, I just said that sounds good.
Yeah. Don't we just need the general sense that we're going to, we support the project.
Yeah.
Right? I would imagine you get that from us, you go do all your due diligence, and you come back and say, I want to do it on the 19th.
I will be happy to tell you the day.
Isn't that the way?
Yeah.
So, all right, that's fine. No motion needed. Whatever you're comfortable with, Dick, does that give you enough?
It certainly makes it easy for me because I have, as I say, I have these people.
I think the consensus on that one is go for it.
Okay. And obviously, if you came back and the date, somebody came up with some reason why you wouldn't have it, then it'd be a stumbling block.
Now, regarding the marine flea market, I would support it. My feeling, Joe, I'm sensitive to your points. I think what we would do is just, Dick said he's going to restrict it to a number of tables.
Yeah, we want to do that because the lot isn't that big.
Okay, what number of tables do you want?
Well, you've encouraged me. I was going to say 20, but I'd like to say more than that now. I'd like to say 40.
Why don't we say...
Wouldn't we get a plant, like, where are you... Well, thinking about holding this.
Well, this is our property, north of that line, roughly speaking.
I gave
so
Kim
there.
A picture that they would be centered around the front of the building.
So it would be over in this area, apparently.
I'm just learning of this the first time, too.
I do think, Dick, and this is just for everybody's edification, I think Joe raises a salient point. Whether it's the flea market or a future event, there's going to be an event that's going to cause some consternation with the people on First Cliff, probably even some people on Second Cliff. Whether it's going to be this event or another one, at some point that's going to happen. And, of course, I think we have to be prepared to address that issue because it's going to probably create problems for access and so on and so forth. So I think that's a valid concern Joe raises. And, again, whether it's the flea market or something else, I don't know. You don't know. But it's going to happen, and you better have some kind of something prepared because they're going to be coming in here talking to us about it. Like they did with the bicycle race that we had last fall and so many others, because we're the ones that are going to be on the firing line.
Well, I understand
that. I just say that I think, you know, I'm not sure whether this flea market's going to do it, but I will say that's a valid concern.
At some point, it could be a wedding, it could be something where you got more people showing up than you think. Now, in terms of a map, you said you gave us a map as to where it's going
to
be?
I sent it to Kim. Remember that? A picture?
Of how it's going to be set up?
Yeah.
Yeah,
I showed it to her that way, which was in front of the building, and I said, this is what I'm anticipating.
And and Mark and the boatyard people have signed off on that specific location?
Yes.
Okay.
The only other thought I had was, don't we typically go to the abutters to see if they support? I mean, again, flea market may have more of a negative connotation than the event you may be trying to run, but you know, we could have 15 people at our meeting in 2 weeks saying, what are you guys doing? So we kind of like to be ahead of the curve on that.
Well, I think if you did, I'd cancel it. I mean, I don't particularly want to do that, but I've not seen, I don't know all the abutters and all the rest of that, but I don't think you're going to see this kind of traffic. It's not where they come and stay for 3 hours. It's more like people come back and forth as they do right now going to the Scituate Maritime Center. I see people coming in and out all day long.
And Dick, as you know, as you've heard, I'm very much in support of this, but devil's advocate, many people coming in and going out is almost worse than if you had 50 people come in and stay for 3 hours than 50 people leave. So there's a flip side on every coin here. And again, I'm saying that in support, you know?
If you had, I'm going to use 30 tables for numbers.
Okay.
Even 30 tables with the adequate amount of space in between them for walking, and et cetera, forgetting about the traffic coming in and out now, it would take up a good part of that boatyard, at least the area that's designated as ours.
No, we're talking about card tables that most people use. Joe, I'm basing this, I don't know if any of you have ever been to the MIT flea market on electronics. No. I have gone there years. It's run out of a garage on campus. And I've been there. People come, they use the back of their vehicle in some cases, which I've done. They bring in a card table, because that's all you're allowed to bring in is a card table. It's the width of a car, essentially. And so when I say 30, that's basically what I'm thinking of. Now, we are going to allow some commercial sellers, and we're thinking those will be probably about 5 of them, and they can have something which would be more on the order of a standard 6-foot table, which is double a card table. But, well, you guys are optimistic. Actually, I'm sitting here smiling, thinking, my golly, maybe we'll make some money for the Scituate Maritime Center. As you know, this is a building that has to support itself. And these are the kinds of things that we come up with to support it.
Joe, I think it can certainly handle that number, I mean, in all honesty. However, that doesn't, I think, in some ways that agrees with your point. I mean, I think it could handle a lot more people, that, and that's exactly the potential problem in terms of the traffic. So I don't agree with you in terms of, like, can the site handle it, but I do worry, as you and John pointed out, about the enhanced traffic, because I think it can handle all that, you know?
It's 3 hours, it's not 8 hours, you know what I mean? So that's a plus in my mind. It's
Sunday morning, so.
You know, I guess when I see something like this, I want to vote for it, you know what I mean? It's I like the idea, and you're absolutely right that the building and the whole concept is self-funding, is self-sufficient, and we have to find ways to, we can't tell your group to go maintain this building and then turn you down for ideas. It's hard to do it. I say we can't. It's hard to do it. You know my concerns. I guess I'm willing to. Well, we'll see.
I just voiced my concerns earlier. I'd say try it. See where it goes after the first year. I think you and I share Joe's concerns. And you know the bridge is narrow and. Yeah. You know, it is a busy time. I just, some ways, I hope it's going to stay small. I would have a problem if, you know, half a dozen people came up and they couldn't launch their boats, they couldn't park or something like that.
Right.
So, say try it.
If this was something other than a nautical
event,
if I could put it that way, thank you, John, then I would vote no, you know, if we were selling beads and stuff like that. But
clearly.
I will reluctantly support it.
Yeah, well, my concern is still the activity of people trying to get their boats in.
Yeah, and that's 3 hours.
Well, you have to understand, there's only so many boats you can put in. The boats have to be put in by the operator. It's not like a person comes there and it's a ramp. So what the Brian Curie and that company would know is actually what's being launched that day, because they have to schedule it. They have to use their travel lift. They have to get it down. If you're asking how many are going to be launched, typically I don't think they launch more than 10 boats in a day on a really good day, and that's when the tide is high and you don't have a low tide because you can't get them out. it's not the same as a regular launch ramp where you would have it at Jericho.
And that's why I explicitly asked, have you cleared this with the boat operator? Because the boat operator is the only person that's moving boats.
Well, if it's a problem for him this year, I am sure we'll hear about it.
Yeah.
So, how?
I'm just going to just say, I'm prepared to give it a shot, see how it goes. My only concern, as I say, is there's going to be an event, and I think there's going to have to be something put in place because whether it's noise or whether it's going to be restrictions on the roadway and people not being able to go, I'm not necessarily open to trying to go to the abutters and trying to get their blessings on an event because, sure enough, there's always going to be somebody who says no. And once you get into that situation, then you got the tail wagging the dog. So I do think, though, that we have to be cognizant and somewhat understanding. That's why I go back to Joe's concern. We do have to be aware of it. And again, this is our first year out, so we'll test it. But I think, and I'm not saying you're not, Dick, and anybody else is, but I just think that's where we have to kind of take a look at each and every event as it comes. And I'm sure we're going to get people complaining, and we can always say, well, they're being a little overly, but I'm sure there'll be some complaints that are probably legit. So, again, that's the concern I have. If it turns out it's a problem, then obviously we'll have to reassess that next year.
Should we limit it to 20 tables or something? Pardon? Should we limit it to 20 tables or something? Or you want to let them just do
see
that?
See where it goes.
See okay. where it goes. That's what I would do.
Okay. How we
what you bring back, if you don't mind, is I would be happy to come back after the event
sure.
and get the feedback
great,
and hear what, you know.
Probably not a bad idea.
Great idea.
We, before you talk, we probably got the votes, so.
Don't yeah, yeah, you might not want to.
be careful.
That the boat operator's lease runs from May to October. We have the entire use of the property except the southern half where he runs his boat yard operations. Contract by lease, the boats should be moved up the northern part of the property, which frees up 160 parking spaces.
Okay.
For John Hughes.
All right.
Want a motion?
Go ahead.
Move that the Board of Selectmen allow Mr. Dick Eckhout, Mr. Richard Eckhouse, to hold the Maritime Flea Market on Sunday, May 23rd, 2010, from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. and allowing the sellers to come at 9 a.m. to set up as described in this information flyer.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
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 One last question.
Get out of Dodge.
I'm sorry.
Be careful, Dick.
What do I do if I need to have a rain date?
I would try to figure out a rain date and...
Well, can I ask for that now in the sense of, I don't know what May 23rd is going to be like, and that was my advisor said to me, what are you going to do if it rains?
How about may I make a
suggestion? Can I amend that motion
would
with the same motion?
When does he want the rain date?
Can we just make it a week later?
With a rain date.
Not Memorial. I wouldn't say Memorial Day.
Not Memorial. Okay.
With a rain date.
Any of those days, huh?
With a rain date of the following of the next successive Saturday that is not a holiday weekend.
Sunday. 2 weeks from that.
Whatever. Next successive Sunday that's not a holiday.
Fine, we'll make it 2 weeks later. That's
fine. I need a second for that.
I'll second that amended motion.
Motion's been made, amended, and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Go for it.
And the other one is okay if I can do it in June.
Yep.
Thank you.
Well, you need to come back and request permission.
Tell us the date.
Yes, I understand. I will tell you the date as soon as I can find it out.
Yeah.
He doesn't need
best
to come
buddies.
In. He just needs to tell us the date.
Yeah.
Okay.
He's already approved the event.
Okay, fine.
Dick, you don't need to come back for the next one.
Just tell
us
Trish.
The date.
I understand.
Trish of the date. Yeah, all right.
Best buddies, are they here? This is a request for the use of Scituate Streets. Two streets, actually, Neal Gate and 3A, not a lot of such small section of Scituate. Any discussion from the board?
Is this 11th annual?
This is on June 5th, Saturday.
June 5th. Yep.
The day that it's going to be a rain date.
Well, I have a feeling it won't be a conflict.
This just cuts the corner, right? This is Neal Gate to
how many?
Yeah. It's just 3A, yeah.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to grant a special events permit to Best Buddies International for the 11th Annual Best Buddies Bicycle Challenge on Saturday, June 5th, 2010, from 9 a.m. to 10 a.m., in accordance with all conditions set by Scituate Fire Police, DPW Building, Health and Recreation.
Second.
Motion been made and seconded.
What's Best Buddies? I'm just curious. I wish they showed up, but I guess it's...
Oh, I'll tell you, we can...
All right.
All in favor?
I'll vote for it. Aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Been here for 11 years.
You go right by Tony, will tell you when they go by his house.
John Patterson Memorial Road Race, next. If you would. How are you tonight? Good, thank you for being so patient.
Hi, Jill.
Why don't you just explain what...
This is our ninth annual Sean D. Patterson Memorial Road Race, and it's a completely nonprofit race that we've run for the 9 years that we've been doing it. In the past 9 years, 8 years, that we've given out scholarships to the high school, we've given out over 70,000 in scholarships to Scituate students in Sean's name. The race route that we use is the old T.K. O'Malley's road race. I think the Scituate police actually have used the route in the past also. It's a proven route to not have any issues as far as traffic and whatnot. We've worked in the past. This is the first year that we've had to come before you. I guess things have changed as far as the way it goes, but in the past we've always met with the fire and the police, the schools, recreation department. We've kind of done all the different
highway,
done everything, Board of Health. We get our permits all individually, so this is kind of different for us. We're new at this, part of it.
We'll make it as easy as possible here.
But I think we submitted all the, like, where the roadblocks have to be and where we man. We do, the police department tells us how many policemen we have to have for it, and then we have volunteers that also are there to direct and whatnot along the route.
And commend you for the amount of money that's donated to the high school scholarship. That's great, as we all know, the cost of higher education.
Great.
Joe, go ahead, Joe.
I was going to say, great event, and obviously wholeheartedly support it. I'd give you a motion, but Sean, is this...
No, I just, it's pretty nice to see these comments from the fire and police. Have you ever seen these before? Very well run, very well. I mean, you know, it's all the hard work you guys do. Good luck.
Thank you.
So it starts at Gates?
Mm-hmm.
Is there like a little event area there, or is that just, do you end at Gates? I'm trying to map.
It starts at Gates, and it starts on Cudworth, and then it ends right at the gates where the two pillars
right.
are there at the end. At the school, we use the school, we use the bathroom, we hire one of the janitors to be there for it. And it leaves there, goes down First Parish Road, it splits on Brook Street. The 5K goes up Hazel Ave, and the 10K goes straight through the harbor to Brook Street, through Brook Street and out and around the lighthouse, and then they meet back up again at Beaver Dam and...
Tilden,
thank you.
And then they go back, and there's an event at Gates after.
Back at the school, we have an award ceremony. We have water and fruit and granola refreshments for the runners.
Right.
We have an award ceremony. Every year, Mass Maritime comes with a color guard. And
that's great.
And they have a children's children's
It's a fun
too,
event, actually. We get a good attendance every year.
Good luck this year.
Motion?
Sure. Move that the Board of Selectmen vote to grant a special events permit to the Sean D. Patterson Memorial Scholarship Road Race on Sunday, April 18th, 2010, from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m., in accordance with all the conditions set by the Scituate Fire, Police, DPW, Building, Health, and Recreation.
Second.
Motion been made and seconded. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Now, if people are interested, how do they
sign up? There's a website, coolrunning.com. They can sign up on that. They can sign up the day of it.
Say that again, just so people watching.
Coolrunning.com. Yeah.
And if they sign up by tomorrow, they get a benefit of $10, right? And a shirt, or, well, they might.
$5 cheaper, and they get a T-shirt. So. There's a fun run for the kids. There's a walk and a 5K and 10K run.
Can you confirm? John said he signed up. Is that true?
Not yet. Tomorrow I sign up. I'll sign up after, now that we voted for it, I'll sign up for it.
I didn't know you could drive that far, John.
I'm running it this year.
Don't keep an eye out for him, would you?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Al, Kevin?
Good evening.
How are you tonight?
Fine, thank you. Al Bangert, Public Works.
publicly working.
Working publicly as well.
The next item on your agenda is awarding a contract for sewer inflow and infiltration engineering. Background is that our municipal sewer system, which is 32 miles of pipe built over the last 43 years, leaks. We have a very high water table in our community, so that any leaks in this collection system mean that the water in the ground leaks into the collection system and has to move through all the pipes to the treatment plant, where this basically clean water is treated unnecessarily, wasting chemicals and electricity. To give you some perspective of how much sewage we have and how much sewage we treat, the actual sewage coming from our fee-paying customers is between 450 and 650 thousand gallons a day. At the sewer treatment plant, we treat three times that amount of liquids. The result is we're treating about 850,000 gallons of fresh water every single day, wasting chemicals, the energy, equipment maintenance, and manpower. And all of this good groundwater, after it's treated, is then pumped out to the ocean and is lost from our watershed. So what we aim to do is continue the work we've been doing over the past to tighten up the system and find the leaks. We want to accelerate that work by hiring an engineering firm who can help us with this in a more technical manner. Right now, the way we find leaks is we go out with our own people with cameras and we look down pipelines. We decided that in order to ramp this up, what we did was we went out and solicited and received four proposals from qualified engineering firms who were experienced in doing this I&I investigative work. A team of Bob Rowland, Kevin Cafferty, and myself then evaluated the four proposals, and as a result of that, we recommend that we select the firm called Tie and Bond of Pocasset, Massachusetts, based upon the strength of their proposal, our previous experience in working with them on both drainage work and the work at the landfill and other projects in the past, and importantly, the competitiveness of their fee. The funding for this work is provided by inflow and infiltration appropriations that were authorized at the 2009 annual town meeting, and is that the payment for this is funded by the sewer enterprise, sewer users.
Thank you. Just before we start, should be pointed out that this is almost required, it is required, I guess, of the town by DEP to do this type of work. So
yes. Actually, Mr. Norton, we prior to even entertaining the idea of going after an engineering firm to help us, we spoke with the DEP and asked them, who is the very best in the state at this I&I work? Who has done it right and who has no problems? Mm-hmm. And the answer from the DEP is, you never get it done. You always have to work on it. All towns are working on it. Yep. It's a continuous operation. Now, if we were to have installed the sewer lines originally and all steel pipes and all steel pipes running up to people's houses and we weren't in ground that was constantly settled, then we might have a tighter system. But this system that was installed as of the 60s, as most systems were, all tend to develop leaks in their clay pipes and in their joints. And so as a result, as you say, the DEP requires that all towns continually invest in I&I work.
Thank you. Discussion?
Just one quick question. Were you surprised at that number? I think that's the first time I've seen the amount of fresh water we treat.
I was surprised. I was thinking that we
spent a lot of money through
twice as much capacity if we were really to get the I&I out. But we've calculated on several different bases how much sewage is coming from our fee-paying customers based upon how much water they're receiving. If you look at the water that people receive in their homes and say that all of that goes into their sewer system.
Which it doesn't. Right.
That still gives you the baseline of between 450 and 650, 650,000 gallons a day, and we treat three times that.
Because we were always told, and I was looking at Richie when you were reading those numbers, we were always told this I&I project in the beginning, Joe, we were going to go after the biggest leaks for the least amount of dollars. So I never would have guessed that that's...
What happened originally was the program has always been well managed. I don't mean to not indicate that it was. The early on, the engineering firms that were used with the town went after fixing all of the main lines. So we don't really have main line problems by and large. We may have some problems with some of the manholes, with some of the basins and that sort of thing, because things settle and sure. cracks develop. Where the problem is in the 2,600 household lines that run from our main sewer up to the household. Those are laid by independent drain layers. Those were laid in the past with clay pipe sections that were just sectioned together. If they weren't properly settled and whatever, the lines will break open and then water gets in. And you know, we've seen right now, today and yesterday, the sewer plant is running at absolute maximum capacity, and we're having potential backups in the system.
But
so,
will this tie and bond thing, are they going to be looking between the road and the house?
Yes, tie and bond.
Good.
We're going to use a combination. We're not, you know, if we find something in main line, obviously we'll fix it, but
sure.
a combination of camera work, smoke testing, dye water testing,
yeah.
Is looking for areas where there are, it may be that driveway drains have been mistakenly plumbed into the sewer, sump pumps have been mistakenly plumbed into the sewer, roof leaders have been plumbed into the sewer. There will be household inspections by licensed plumbing inspectors. We have the right to go and inspect our system, so there may be some of that kind of work going on. So it's a very comprehensive program that will lead up to then the specific fixes that we will then go out for bid to fix.
Al, how the amount that's been authorized, we'll authorize in a minute, it seems like it's awfully small. For this is for the entire town?
No, it's only about one third of the town, like the older sections that we're picking.
Okay.
And it encompasses, I think, like 60,000 feet of camera work, 14 smoke tests, and we're just going to focus in certain areas where we think we're getting
right.
the most leaks.
So when you find a leak, for example, or I assume last year when we've done the same thing, we found leaks with
right.
people. So what happens? What
the
do we
one
do
technology
as a
is called cast in place, where you, you dig a hole, find the line, and slide in a liner. It's inflated. It hardens in place and forms a new pipe within a pipe.
Okay.
Part of the old-fashioned way, digging it up and just replacing the pipe.
Yeah. And
but what if it's on the? In other words, some of these are going from the main line to a private home. So you
is.
Find that a private home is.
It's on private lines. We go on
so
private lines. We get permission from the homeowner. Yeah. As we have to balance the cost of lining in place versus just digging and replacing.
I see.
And the it's a cost balance there.
Right.
Now,
go ahead, sorry.
200,000 or 184,000 as we have here doesn't seem like a lot, but we've appropriated chunks of $400,000
yep.
annually
oh,
for
yeah.
this work. So, and we have on the appropriation for this year $400,000 for the fix work. What we said is, instead of just plugging away at onesies and twosies with our own guys doing camera work at night while they're still trying to run the sewer plant during the day, let's amp up with some qualified an engineering team that will come in and spend quality time and new techniques and find the leaks, and then we can go back and do the fixes.
Tony, you had a comment?
Yeah, I think you answered my question. So these people are doing the investigative work, and we're going to have to do the repair work.
They'll do the investigative work, yes.
One thing for people that are watching, if we do happen to find a leak that's on somebody's property, it gets fixed at the town's expense.
Yeah.
So
yes.
the homeowner doesn't have to, we won't find something on their house that they've got a faulty connection and then hit them with a bill. We would have to
Yes.
repair it ourselves.
Yeah. If it's a leak in the pipe, we have been replacing those. If there's a faulty connection, such as a sump pump connected to the sewer, which is illegal, there may be some expense for the homeowner to reroute their sump pump.
Are there any fines?
I hope you know you were kind enough to say mistakenly a sump pump could be hooked up to the sewer. That's a pretty good mistake.
Well, we had an amnesty thing a couple years ago, didn't we?
Yeah.
And
that worked, I think.
It worked pretty well.
A couple
well.
Of sections.
We had at least several tens of people, I think.
An amnesty program, it's getting a relatively small response right now.
Yeah,
I don't
but,
think
but it, when it first came in, I think you had some response.
I think there's, yes, very true.
Yeah.
And in fact, we provided connections, places whereby people could connect directly to the stormwater system.
Mm-hmm.
Then they would need to run it to the stormwater system, but we would provide a place for connection at the street.
Yeah.
And on those streets up in the Sand Hills area, the ABC streets, I think it was, where that was done.
Yeah.
And then that worked
yeah, yeah.
right now. But, you know, I think we have, we're more likely to find that we have sewer manhole covers that are just not seated properly, or cracks around sewer manholes, as well as the lateral leaks. I think that's going to be the big money.
Motion.
Move that the Board of Selectmen vote to award the contract for sewer inflow and infiltration investigation and rehabilitation, contract number 10-WW-01, to Teagan Bond Engineers of Pocasset, Massachusetts, in the amount of $184,000.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Discussion, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Next, generator number 12 is another engineering service contract. Al, Kevin?
This is for award of a contract for evaluation of the Cedar Point seawall that's come up a couple times. We have a lot of damage to that seawall, and it's about 1,400 feet. This contract is to evaluate it and come up with plans. The evaluation includes chlorine into the structure, taking some samples, coming up with the plans and the specs and everything else to fix it. This is funded by a DCR grant, which we received for $50,000. We're waiting on the final paperwork for it, but we had already put out the RFP. As soon as we get the paperwork from the DCR, we'd like to award the contract to Coastline Engineering, CLE Engineering, and get to work on that wall.
I think this is a section of seawall that we've discussed three or four times here. I think we had conversations with you about trying to do this as soon as possible. We lucked out, I guess, and get some state funding to be able to do it sooner rather than later, so I think it's great.
We get three prices. Yeah. I think they're very competitive. Yep. Our low price is really competitive. The engineering firm's a little hungry, I think, to get the work.
Yep.
And we're happy with it. And we can probably find a use for the rest of the money.
Oh, is this just the stretch of wall where that, or Kevin, where that, where the opening is at the end of Rebecca?
It's the opening. It's about 1,400 feet of wall right in that area there, yes. From, there's two sections.
It's not the wall behind the houses closer to the ocean. It's that, the stretch that you can walk onto the beach.
Well, that, it
no,
is.
It is the house.
Oh,
it is
the house. Yeah. Yeah. All the way down.
Goes from Rebecca Road all the way down to the end of Jericho.
Road is that 1,400 feet from Rebecca Road to the opening. It's an evaluation of that whole seawall.
Yeah.
Okay, so it is. From
Rebecca Road north.
Where the
north.
Parking lot is in, yep, the little beach. It's basically from there.
All the way down to the opening.
But this isn't going to fix it. It's just going to study it, design it, permit it, and also.
This is so that if there is some money that becomes available that we can apply for grant-wise, we have shovel-ready plans to go in case another stimulus project comes.
And this is CLA. Beware of change orders.
Motion, Joe?
Please.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to award the engineering contract for the preliminary design permitting, final design, and solicitation of bids for seawall project at Cedar Point to CLE Engineering of Marion, Massachusetts, in the amount of $32,940. The award of this contract is subject to receipt of a grant from DCR for $50,000.
Second.
Further discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you.
Thank you very much.
The next is a discussion and vote on Article 22 of the special town meeting.
Thank you, Tricia.
I think we are all familiar with this also. This is the land on Stockbridge Road. Thank you, Tricia. These are the motions Tricia's been kind enough to give us tonight.
Jeez.
This is great. John Hallen, would you like to just bring us up to date and what we'll be voting on as far as you?
Sure.
We put this right between John and I. How's that? You can look on.
Right here's good. Thank you.
It's in the back. Is it?
And this is March 9th.
The most recent.
March 9th?
12th.
What's the date on that, Kim?
3/12 on this one.
It says March 12th.
March 9th?
It's
yeah, same thing?
Is this the same one?
It's the same.
Yeah. No, this shows two lots.
Yes.
This shows two lots. It shows two lots. This is not the right plan. There you go. We need the right plan.
No, that's the plan. It's two lots.
It's two lots.
I need some help.
That's the plan that the planning board approved. That is not the direction of the board in approving the article to be a town meeting.
The planning board hasn't approved the plan yet. They're waiting to hear from you guys. We came up tonight. We had talked with some of the neighbors at one of the planning board meeting, and originally we were in with three house lots, and we looked at that very well, and there was some concern from the neighbors about the proximity of where the house were going to go and some confusion. So in lieu of that, what we had done in talking to our board, as well as getting information from you guys, that the third lot, again, you guys had intended to sell. And what we had done, the Affordable Housing Trust, was that the possibility if we could buy that lot from you guys and have the proposal up as a two-lot proposal with one single-family home and a duplex that would give us a count of still three affordable housing. This would give us a plan that we knew what was going on there. We presented to the neighbors, everyone knowing what was going on there, rather than the third lot as being something that we're not sure of to go forward with.
So just so I can clarify, because I'll tell you, I have to be honest with everybody. This is the most confusing article, I think, that I have ever dealt with. The proposal that we heard a week or two ago about the Affordable Housing Trust buying for $100,000 this land and giving a piece to the Habitat for Humanity.
Yes.
Is that still on the table?
Yes.
That is. Okay. All right.
Then how come we have two lots here?
But are we talking two lots or three lots?
Okay.
Can you
clarify
that?
Okay.
Somebody help me.
Okay. If we all remember, first came before this board was a proposal to subdivide the lot with three potential lots, one for affordable housing, one for Habitat for Humanity, one for Homes for Our Troops. That was just a pure three-lot subdivision. Regardless of who was going to get it, the board had said they were interested in being able to say one will go to affordable housing and one will go to Habitat for Humanity. The issue came up that the third lot the board would like to be able to take and maybe potentially sell in the future. Now, as a result of that direction, Mr. Hallin and Mr. Lane went to the planning board. And when they went to the planning board, they were only looking to give information and guidance to the planning board, but the planning board told them that you're going to need to do a Form A, which means that you need to do a formal subdivision. And we're not going to approve a three-lot subdivision. We're only going to approve a two-lot subdivision. So Mr. Hallin and Mr. Lane walked out of the meeting because now they weren't going to be able to have three homes there, affordable and Habitat for Humanity, but also the lot that we wanted as a board wasn't going to be able to be carved out.
Because of the planning board?
Because of the issues that came up at the planning board.
Okay.
Now, Mr. Hallin, and I'm not sure if Mr. Lane were party to it, I presume they were, talked to some of the abutters, talked to the issues that they raised, and then went back to the proverbial drawing board and came up with a two-lot subdivision. However, in light of that, they took in the considerations of some of the abutters to say, okay, if we can appease them, would they be happy? And that's what this is proposed right now, because the abutter is, because there's not going to be any house close to the abutters. But also, in light of the new plan, there still can be three lots, or three homes, three residences.
Okay.
There. One of which is actually Habitat for Humanity. The other would be Affordable Housing Trust. However, the trust would then have a duplex. Mm-hmm. However, the trust wants to be able to buy that third lot, although it's not represented here, because in essence, we as a board could possibly sell it, and the trust was authorized to say that they would buy, in essence, or pay $100,000 in order to buy the right to be able to have a duplex, mm-hmm. so they could have two affordable homes there. So in essence,
I lost you on that last part.
The trust is going to spend $100,000 in order to have lot two, two lots, to be able to have a duplex there.
Pay
the town $100,000 to be able to have two affordable homes there. The third affordable home will be Habitat for Humanity. So,
can I have a clarification? Just a quick one, because I was with you till right to the very end. Planning board said two lots.
And then there was, one of them's a duplex, one of them's a single family.
Planning board just said two lots.
Two lots, okay. And then these guys said duplex.
Correct.
Okay. And then did it go back to a third lot that they would then?
No.
It's been two lots, so now it's just two lots. Except what we're able to do, the trust is able to do, is to be able to put a duplex on, because they have adequate lot size and frontage to be able to put a duplex on, in essence, that second lot.
So I thought the $100,000
was to buy that third lot.
But the $100,000 now was to buy, to pay for.
All three lots.
A duplex.
They had to put a duplex.
But so the, Rick, the three lots were going to be originally three single-family homes, which would be three units.
Right.
Two of which. So what we essentially did with the same land area, we made two lots. One of the two lots will have a duplex on it to count for two affordable units, and then the other lot will have a single-family home on it. So our total will be three affordable units.
Three affordable units on two lots.
Yes.
One's a duplex, town gets $100,000.
And that's exactly what.
And Habitat for Humanity.
A month ago, 6 weeks ago, what we talked about was Habitat for Humanity getting a house, a lot, excuse me, the Affordable Housing Trust getting a lot, now two, and the town would receive $100,000.
Correct.
Yes.
And that appears to be what we were at tonight.
Yes. And in that same sense, in talking to the neighbors and getting their approval, there we felt comfortable with this, and that at the end run.
If that's where we are, beautiful. Joanna, maybe you.
Joanna Chisholm, Chair of the Planning Board. The night that this presentation came in, it was just an informal discussion. We did not find out about the Form A until we got there that night, at least myself. We were a little bit shocked because back in October, Rich Lane met with the neighbors and discussed a two-lot plan. And from October to February, it turned into a three-lot plan, and it went from Rich Lane's project to the Affordable Housing Trust.
Mm-hmm.
At the point where I talked to Rich and Billy Lopes, no one from the Affordable Housing Trust had talked to the neighbors at all. So in that time span, when we met that night, we were kind of taken aback. We thought our what we were supposed to be doing was to get what could fit on that property, which could be three lots.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, we had to take off the second fairway,
yep.
Which was included in that, which brought you down to a lot less land. And when we were looking at the three lots, one of the houses was placed behind Billy Lope's house. So not only does he get three affordable homes on three lots, he gets one behind his house, blocking what he has with you now. So the planning board asked Mr. Hallin to withdraw the Form A as presented, and they went out and discussed in the hallway what they were going to do with two lots. So it, again, it has been a confusing thing. And I just want to say $100,000 thing, I don't think is going to really go well at town meeting, because it's town-owned land that we pay the CPA money, the townspeople, and our taxes. And now you're going to say that we're going to take $100,000 from the Housing Trust on and buy town property that the town already owns.
Well,
so
you,
kind of, just,
you may or may not be correct, but that's not what we're discussing here tonight, whether it'll go, to, you know, with that aspect.
But is the meeting tonight about how the motion is going to be presented? Is that what we're...
The meeting tonight is how we're going to, whether we'll support the article.
Okay.
And
that,
soon
I mean,
to be revised.
I don't want the planning board to be blamed for knocking it down to two lots, because we thought we were giving you guys directions of what the informal discussion was about. We had no idea we were going to be looking for May. We didn't know until, I think, that afternoon that the Form A was coming in.
But Donna, if a private developer, if the town wasn't the town and was a private developer, would they tell a developer, we're going to take three lots and give you two because it's too close to the neighbor's backyard?
No.
You wouldn't do that for a private
developer.
Have,
I think we have made accommodations for developers to cut back on lots because we felt they were too many, absolutely. Absolutely.
All right. I guess, again, as I say, the initial thought was to for the town to, rather than sell the whole parcel to a developer and prohibit these two organizations from building, draw up something that they would get what they wanted, and we would receive $100,000 or whatever. That looks like where it's at now, Sean.
I was at the planning board meeting, and in the end, we're getting what we wanted, like you said, in the end. And I agree with Tricia. How we get there, it's all different ways we're getting there, but we're getting there. The whole thing started with Richie, and if Richie didn't bring this to our attention, we wouldn't be having this discussion right now. So the fact is, if Richie gets his the Habitat House, John does the, you know, gets one for the trust, and we're able to generate funds. The whole thing, you probably know how it started, if I can just address Donna's concerns. When we were discussing, you know, giving up this land, you know, for a dollar, a developer approached us and said, you know, the times were in his, you know. Right. So this is how this all came about. We're trying to satisfy everyone, correct, Joe?
We're trying to satisfy everybody and deal with the extreme budget crisis here in the town of Scituate, and that means raising fees, that means raising beach sticker fees, that means raising parking tickets, it means raising inspectional fees, it means, if possible, garnering $100,000 from the sale of this, and if anyone else has any other ideas, we welcome them to.
And I have no question on that, but
yep.
The question remains, and as all of you know, this has been a problem to get the neighbors to this point. As far as, I mean, the last one fell through because, again, the neighbors weren't addressed. It was done behind their back. With the planning board trying to do a housing plan and try to get everyone educated on affordable housing, because most people don't realize what it is. And we had four people show up at the hearing. So four people got educated in town, and the rest of the town still doesn't understand what affordable housing is. But unfortunately, the Affordable Housing Trust also really didn't go to the neighbors again. Richie went first. They really didn't address the neighbors. The neighbors are told two lots, and then all of a sudden it becomes three when the Affordable Housing Trust jumped in. And I know that originally Rich had come in for that property, and you guys said okay, and then a couple weeks later the Affordable Housing Trust came in. So it's almost like a whammy on both sides.
Well,
I think you've got the neighborhood involved with the two lots. Let it go and prove what a wonderful project it will be for the town.
I think we're irregardless of the bumps in the road to get here, I think the important thing is that we leave here with what everybody wants, and that's what I hope to accomplish here tonight. Tony?
Just part of the story is being completely missed here, and this is, we're getting, the end game is going to end up being the same, but a couple quick comments. When you came before us last time, we asked you to go to the planning board to see if you could get four lots on the property. And all of a sudden we get an email the next day saying it's two. That's the frustration. Then all of a sudden I get an email back that says, well, if we twist a house a little bit and get it away from there, then it can work for three perfectly. So now we come back and we get a plan for two. I mean, it's just not being followed the way that we've asked the project to be done. And I know it's frustrating because Richie came with the project. It's a good project. But then we got an offer, and it's our fiduciary responsibility to look into this stuff. What you're saying about the Affordable Housing Trust, they frankly came in and kind of put the pieces together at the end. They're not to fault for anything. You know, these guys did the due diligence and went to the people beforehand to see what the neighborhood's feel was. And that trust came in and said, okay, well, here's a way that we can do it. They can make it work for everybody. You know, I think Tricia had a good point that if it was just a regular developer, there'd be at least three lots there and at least three houses there, if not nine, I heard you could put there possibly on the property. But my point is when we're here and we're looking at a plan and we want to go in a certain direction and all of a sudden we get answers back that are in the complete opposite direction, it's very frustrating. And not to beat up this any more than it has to, because it seems like it may work in that direction. But Don is correct. This could go to town meeting, and then all of a sudden, the town doesn't get the $100,000, and now we've got a two-lot proposal instead of a three-lot proposal, where we have the ability to sell the third lot. So, so it just feels like we're trying to do what we think is in the best interest of the town, and we're not getting the answers back that we're looking for. And that's what's frustrating me in the process. If it all works out fine in the end, then so be it, but...
Just on the point on the plan, this plan, if it, assume for your ratification, in the event that this plan doesn't pass town meeting, this plan is not the plan on the ground. Until that gets recorded, once it's recorded, then it's a two-lot. So in other words, if this fails at town, we can go back and we can subdivide it even to four lots, or three lots, in other words, and then we can sell each one off independently. And I'm not trying to sell anybody short here, but I'm saying, town meeting says no to this plan's no longer any good, so we can go back
but
and
also, I mean, just...
You mean this plan hasn't been filed at the
registry? Right. Once it goes to
the
registry of deeds, it is now in effect in the ground.
Understood.
So I'm just saying...
But there was also a request today that said, can we have the most recent plan that has three lots on it, and then we come here and we get a piece of paper that has two on it. So it's
I just feel, to the defense, and I'm not to the defense of poor John, I mean, I tend to think he's between a rock and a hard place. Totally. I realize he's got the direction of the Board of Selectmen. The Board of Selectmen are the ones who've dictated it. They went to the planning, and planning said something completely different. He's trying to make amends from both boards here. I will say the Board of Selectmen trump the planning board. It's a three-lot, it's what it should be. But to try to accommodate the planning board and then try to accommodate the neighbors, John went out of the way to try to make sure everybody could be happy in the process. So, it's not like they're trying to, hide anything or do a bait and switch. He's been trying
to accommodate. No, I'm not suggesting that.
Oh, no, but for the people who are on TV, because everybody's saying everything's changing constantly. I think they've been trying hard to try to get something going, that's all. So just for the people on TV to understand that.
Rick.
Just briefly. I haven't been a selectman nearly as long as Sean or nearly as long as Joe, obviously. Yeah, exactly. That's right. But I got to say, for a project that everybody really wants to have happen, I can't recall anything that's ever come before us in the last four or five years that's caused so much confusion and consternation for something that everybody in the room approves right from day one in terms of the goals. And I also just want to ask, Richie, do you approve this? Because I've had many conversations with you, and I want to make sure you're cool with this.
Yes, I am.
Okay, period.
Totally.
Thank you.
Habitat gets one lot.
Okay, you get one lot, it's the single family.
Yes.
You're not in the duplex. Are you fine with that, John?
Yes, Alan? That was our original intent. And
okay,
again,
so you guys are both fine, because I feel very committed to you guys, and this board does in terms of the spirit, regardless of the two-lot, three-lot thing. I just want to make sure that your needs for bringing affordable housing under the different auspices are met by this plan.
Yes.
Yes and yes? Okay. So, and then the third thing I want to say is I feel like the selectmen, unfortunately, we're sort of ended up looking a little bit foolish, or not foolish, but a little overly confused than we need to on this. And in the future, and this is not a comment on you guys, but there somehow needs to be better coordination with the planning board, and perhaps the planning board should be the board to see these things first. So the selectmen who own the land, it's our land to deal with, subject to planning board rules and regulations, of course, just like subject to Conservation Commission rulings and regulations, of course, and anybody else too, zoning and so on. So we can be dealing with a final plan that's gone through the other committees first, because I think, as Danahy said, the buck stops with us, or we trump or whatever. We should have gotten this last, because we gave our approval and went back to planning for one reason or another. I'm not casting stones one way or the other. Then it got changed around. These poor guys are running around trying to make ends meet. So I think in the future, people are going to come to us for other pieces of land or something like that. I'm going to be asking, is the planning board signed off on this, either informally or whatever, and so on. So we don't end up with all this yin-yang, because it doesn't represent the town well, doesn't represent the applicants well, and then I think things will be just a lot cleaner. Acknowledging that there still might be some back and forth, because that's the nature of government, but it's got to be better than this, particularly for something we all approve of. So I'm in favor of this. I think we can work out whatever plan we're working on in terms of making sure it gets voted properly on the floor. Let's just go with this.
Is that in a motion, or is that?
I'm fine to make a motion. Can it just be simply to support Article 22,
absolutely,
or do I have to change anything? Okay.
The only thing about this is as simple as the motion.
All right. Move the Board of Selectmen vote to support Article 22 of the special town meeting.
Second.
Well, that.
Discussion.
Yeah. Unfortunately, the way it's written, it says, with this plan, it says they'll get the two lots will be sent to affordable housing. So if this plan gets approved and the town doesn't approve the $100,000 transfer, then
they don't have to approve the town transfer of money. Affordable Housing Trust has money that they can spend to buy land.
This is the annual town meeting.
So the long and short of it is I'm not sure which article, when I say article, because the one that's written has January 7th, and that's not the plan. The plan is March 12th.
March 12th.
So I'm not, and I know that's what's in the booklet. The one that you gave us, I has a little different writing, so I didn't know.
Right, because when the warrant was posted, it was the January 7th plan.
Yeah, the 7th one.
Right, which is three lots.
And then the plan that shows three is March 9th.
Right.
So now I'll change the motion if the board so votes.
Okay.
To change the two-lot subdivision to March 12th.
Do we have to put a plan in?
Yes.
Yeah.
And the plan's actually in the correct plan is actually in here.
March 12th is in there, John?
And what you plan to do with it. And John, I just want to reconfirm that both the lots will be conveyed to affordable housing.
Yes, at which time affordable housing will.
And convey to Rich.
Rich, the single family, as well as the.
Right, that's how I wrote the motion.
As well as the restrictions in, for the driveway that goes through both.
And Mr. Chair, if I could correct that motion, I mistakenly said special town meeting, it's the annual town meeting.
Yeah, it is the annual.
So to your point, John, we'd have to change March 9th to March 12th.
That's all I did.
So the motion reads, move the Board of Selectmen vote to support Article 22 of the annual town meeting.
Second.
Motion been made and seconded. Any further discussion from the board, from the floor? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? It's unanimous.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Who has that article?
John Danny.
You gotta change it to March 12th. I just gave you the motion.
I do. So that's why I just took a look at it, just to make sure.
Moving right along, agenda item 14, discussion vote transfer of funds cable television trust fund. Fisher?
Thank you.
If you'd give us a little background on what this is. Agenda item number 14.
This is for the annual maintenance for the Full Circle Technology GIS software that we have, and it was in budget, and you know, we have to come for you during the fiscal year to pay for this, so it needs to be paid now for maintenance. And this bill splits the fiscal year, unfortunately, so that's why you're seeing it now. The modules are moving along. I don't know, for folks who get an email blast on our website, plumbing and electrical permits now can be downloaded directly from the website. So that's new.
Great.
And buildings actually up and running now, and you'll be hearing some things from them shortly.
Every little step.
Discussion? Motion?
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to transfer $2,600 from the Cable Television Trust Fund for annual maintenance and support software.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Discussion by the board? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. Next is an announcement of the 2010 e-government award for the town website. Tricia, did you go to that, or?
I did.
Would you maybe fill us in on how exciting it was?
Scituate was one of 160 communities that was noted for the third year in a row of having what it pretty much amounts to a very transparent website in terms of town business, public records, and documents. And our website is maintained by Tom Rose, who also received one, I should mention, for another town that he does the website for. So for me personally, I think this is a tremendous recognition for the community, and I'm happy that we're doing it. Next year, we're going to work toward being one of 28 communities that gets the e-government award with distinction. And that requires a little more minutes to be up, such as school committee meetings and other documents. But we're going to work toward that, and I think this is a good achievement for the town in terms of folks being able to find out about their government.
Thank you. I don't think there's a motion necessary here, but just a congratulations to Tom for his continued good work. I think it's probably an honor, and with the board's permission, I guess we publicly thank Tom for all the work he's done and for the good work he's done. Thank you. Next. Is the town administrator's report, always anxiously awaited.
At the end of a long meeting.
Yeah.
You have the financial trend monitoring report covering the period through February. Again, no surprises, as I note here. Our tax collection rate is maintaining steady, and we're very happy with that. And for the first time in several years, snow and ice may not have a deficit, and I think that's in due in part to more rain than snow, but also to the change in the board policies that Mr. Bangert recommended as far as how we approach snow fighting and snow plowing in various parts of the community. So that's a huge help, because what the goal has been from, you know, the last several months is to hold that free cash in abeyance so we really don't have to use it, and we can use it. We can appropriate to stabilization or for capital. So generally, as you know, snow and ice deficits, free cash comes off the top and you're left with very little. So I think that's really good news. Fire overtime seems to be a concern, but the chief said it will be tight, but he believes we'll make it through June 30th. So in general, I'm pretty pleased with this. This is quite a change, as you know, for town departments who really have been held to the line this year as far as the fact that they will be unable to do year-end transfers for budgetary shortfalls because we've been tracking them so judiciously from month to month. And then the second part is just in advance of town meeting, especially if there's questions about the proposal supported by the board and the advisory committee about the technology position and where we're going with technology. I just want to assure the board so they can inform voters at town meeting that a lot of this has not been done in a vacuum and that there's a very predetermined, premeditated plan to develop a short and long-term plan for technology, and it's been going on for the last 3 months and will go on so that we know exactly what we need and what needs to be done when that body comes on board if it's approved at town meeting. It's very, very critical to me for the operation of the town that this position come sooner than later because the needs and the shortfalls that this committee has been identifying for the last 3 months give me more unease than comfort. And so what I've just tried to do without overwhelming you with information is give you a small piece of the work that the technology committee has been doing. These are their minutes, but as you know, there's 8 subcommittees of a whole bunch of other different individuals that are working. And one of the big things, as you can see, and I provided all the work that your departments are doing, is the functional flow analysis to look at the how the process and procedures of our work in town hall and other departments are operated, and to what extent those are manual processes now that we can automate, and what needs to be done, and where there's communities of interest to obtain efficiencies and economies of scale. Yes.
Thank you. I just want to comment, if I may, on the financial committee, the trend monitoring and everything that goes with it. A few years ago, 5-6 years ago, I think Frank says he started this financial forecasting idea, and it was taken up by Tony when he came on the board, and it's invaluable, I think, invaluable to the town to plan ahead and to forecast the monies we'll have in the future, what might interfere with budget planning, what things we have to look out for, trends in expenses, trends in income. And I think I'd like to publicly thank Tony for the work he's put into it in chairing that committee, along with others. And I don't mean to not mention anybody else. There's a lot of people involved in that committee, but the work is I know, a big help to me, and I know a big help to the town administrator and the school committee as well. So a public thank you goes to Tony from me, and I know from the board. Norman.
Are we gonna see the financial?
No. Yes, I think.
You'll see it at, there'll be a handout at town meeting.
Won't be available.
It may be on the website before then, if we're just double checking it right now. We had a meeting last week.
Is it going to be 5 years this time?
It'll be 5 years total. I think it goes out to 14.
Okay. Thank you. Next, other business.
Well, if I could, just one comment on IT stuff is I saw several of your people on the committee point out they just want to have ensure that the public has access to information online, and I think that's a great thing.
We have a subcommittee on customer service.
Yeah, I think that's just outstanding, and I just wanted to reaffirm that and draw attention to that, because that's a real key thing. This is not only going to be internal at Town Hall, but out to the citizenry as well. It's great.
Other business?
John Callahan, I want to congratulate him as a Scituate hockey, boys hockey. I inadvertently earlier this evening forgot to mention his name and have him come up on the podium. I apologize to him afterwards. He did come up with recognition. But I want to congratulate John, his family, and certainly say for a job well done, as well as the other members. That's all I have, Mr. Chair.
John Harris.
Easter egg hunt, Wattles Walk.
Are you going?
Always a big event.
Is that where you get your eggs?
That's how I might, yeah. 8:30, Wattles Walk.
Saturday morning?
That's correct.
Yep. Great. Thank you.
That's all.
Rick Murray?
Nothing.
Nothing?
Oh.
Tony?
Just a quick comment, Norm mentioned on the forecasting meeting, committee got together last week and got the forecast together. With the help of many people from the town and the school committee. So it's really a team effort there to get that project together. And it will be available maybe on the web beforehand, but at least as a handout there. And a couple other people that were very strong in getting the forecasting up and going were Scott Roberts years ago and Paul Reedy. Obviously, he led the charge as a selectman prior to me. So
thank you. Correspondence, John,
yes,
we have a couple of items.
I do. We have one that's actually kind of hits very close to all five of us here in particular. As you all know, I mean, you can look out the window, you see plenty of water coming down. Well, you might remember earlier this month we had a big, huge deluge. Well, out on Cedar Point, there was a plug, if you will, in one of the water pipes, a culvert that would take water out of the parking lot at Cedar Point near the lighthouse out into the ocean. And one of our selectmen, who was handy, ended up going. So we received a letter from a Kathleen Loftus who said, "Dear Kim," and that's our assistant, Kim Donovan, "I'm not sure how to go about this, but I would like to publicly thank Mr. Sean Harris for his kind and selfless help with the clearing of the valve at Cedar Point. It's been a mess out here lately, and we always sweep out in front and clear out our backyards after storms. But this last one was tough with the valve blocked. Water remained at the lighthouse parking lot as well as our backyards and where she is, and it's rough on the grass and for the dogs. Mr. David Ball emailed the Cedar Point Association and told us today, which was March 3rd, that Mr. Harris came out to check out the problems and ended up clearing it himself and getting wet, and I'm sure fairly dirty in the process. This truly exemplifies the role of a public servant, and although it was not expected, it was very much appreciated by my family, and I'm sure by many residents at the point, and all the visitors who drive by the lighthouse on a daily basis. If possible, could you please have Mr. Norton, the chairman, read this note at the next meeting?" So thank you very much, Mr. Harris. Yep. We appreciate it. The other item...
A regular Roto-Rooter, isn't he?
I didn't know we had two Sean Harrises in town.
That's just typical of what hands-on means and what Sean does on almost on a daily basis for people in this
people
town.
People are just very passionate out in the lighthouse.
We thank you, and I know the neighbors out there thank you.
No problem.
So we have another one from Mr. Albert Bangert to the Board of Selectmen. The subject is water main flushing. So, brown water, folks. Here we go. Beginning in April, the water department or division will launch a very aggressive water main flushing program to reduce the incidence, again, the incidence of brown water issues for our residents. Although the brown water is unpleasant in color, it poses no danger to public health and safety. Again, I say, although brown water is not unpleasant, it poses no danger to health and safety. The flushing will be done on Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Thursdays from 9 a.m. in the morning to 2 p.m. in the afternoon. The program will include a thorough public information program using the town email notification system, the website, the Scituate Mariner, Patriot Ledger, WATD, signage, and mailbox hangers. If you desire more information, please contact Jim DeBarrows, the Interim Water Division Supervisor, at
8735.
Thank you. I was missing one digit, folks. That completes the correspondence, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Next item on the agenda is German?
Minutes.
Move the minutes of March 12, 2010.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I abstain, Kim.
Next.
Move to adjourn?
Move to adjourn. Motion been made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Unanimous.